Okay, so today we're going to talk about elementary topology. We're going to start out with just the set theory and talk about Boolean algebra. So let's suppose that A and B are sets. Then A union B is the set of all X such that X is in A or X is in B. A intersect B will be the set of all X such that X is in A and X is in B. If you're fussy about where these X's are, then we can always put the sets A and B inside some bigger set gamma and then just restrict X to Y within gamma. And in that case, the complement of A in gamma is going to be the set of all X in gamma such that X is not in A. And schematically, of course, we have, this is our set gamma, this is our set A, this is our set B. The union of the two sets is this, the intersection of the two sets is this, and then the complement of the two sets is that. So this is complement with respect to gamma of A. That's the complement with respect to gamma of A would be all of that. This is going to be the A intersect B, and then A union B is that bit there. Okay, now we say that B is a subset of A if for every X in B, then X is in A. And we also have a notion of an empty set. This is the empty set with respect to a given set A. So this is going to be the set of all X in A such that X is not equal to X. Now that's a queer definition. It says that these are the set of all elements that are not equal to themselves, and thus there are no such elements. So associated to every set, we have an empty set. And there's a little lemma which says that the empty set A is equal to the empty set for B. So there's a unique empty set, and it has no elements. And the idea is that if the empty set of A is not equal to the empty set of B, then either the empty set of A, there's an element in this set that's not in here, or there's an element in this set that's not in there. So let's say that then there exists a B in the empty set of B such that B is not in the empty set of A, but the empty set of B has no elements. And so this is a contradiction. In general, we have to be careful about the empty set, oftentimes theorems will be stated for a non-empty set. Sometimes they'll be stated with the empty set inclusive. But in topology, the empty set is also an open set. So we'll just denote that by this symbol here. Now, for example, from the empty set, you can construct a set with one element. So you can look at the set consisting of the empty set, and this is a set with one element. And there are other interesting constructions that can be made. simply from that idea. I'd like to review a few of the basic sets that we're going to be dealing with in the topology course. Now, I'm going to give them as set theoretic definitions here, and later on we'll have topologies that are associated to them. First of all, the integers are going to be the set 0 plus or minus 1, plus or minus 2, plus or minus 3, and so forth. The non-negative integers will be the set 1, 2, 3, and so forth. And our author calls the natural number to be the non-positive integers. Some people include 0 as natural numbers, other people do not. The rational numbers are going to be considered to be the set of all a over b such that a and b are integers and b is non-zero. But this is a bit of a lie because we're not really thinking about such fractions, but we're thinking about two such fractions as representing the same rational number, if and only if we can write an equality such as this. So two ratios represent the same number if and only if A1 times B2 is equal to A2 times B1. So we can actually think about the rational numbers as equivalence classes of pairs of integers, although it's not until later on that we define what we mean by equivalence classes. Among these sets, the rational numbers is one of the more topologically interesting sets. The other sets tend to have a discrete topology. We also have real numbers, which we're going to take to be the set of decimals of infinite precision. Within the context of this course, we're not going to define the real numbers. They can be defined by means of Dedekind cuts or equivalence classes of Cauchy sequences, but we're going to take the real numbers as being given. If we have the real numbers, then we can also define the vector space Rn, which would be the set of all ordered n tuples such that each of the elements is in the reals. Inside Rn, we have lots of nice subspaces. In fact, many, although not all, but many of the topological spaces that we'll be dealing with are going to be subsets of Rn. In particular, we have the n minus 1 dimensional sphere, which is the set of all x in Rn, vectors x in Rn, such that, well, since it's in Rn, it's x1, x2, up through xn, and the summation of the xi squared is equal to 1. And then the sphere is the boundary of the n-dimensional ball or the n-dimensional disk. We'll describe explicitly what we mean by boundary later on. And I'd like to define the n-dimensional simplex. So I'll call that delta n. The n-dimensional simplex will consist of vectors in Rn plus 1 such that the sum of the coordinates is equal to 1 and all of the coordinates are non-negative. And so the zero-dimensional simplex that means that we take vectors in R where the coordinate is equal to 1. And so the zero-dimensional simplex is just a point. The one-dimensional simplex, we look at the line x plus y is equal to 1. We look at the portion of the line in the first quadrant, and then we just take the point 1/2. The one-dimensional simplex is this line segment. Of course, the zero-dimensional simplex can be thought as living inside there as the point 1/2, 1/2. That's called the bare center of the simplex. And the two-dimensional simplex is better known as a triangle. It's the set of points in space where the coordinates add to 1 and then all the coordinates are non-negative. So that's that equilateral triangle there. And in 4 space, we can draw a 4 simplex, a 3 simplex, which winds up being a tetrahedron. So the 2 simplex is a triangle. And the 3 simplex is a tetrahedron. And all of these spaces, spheres, balls, simplices, and so forth, are important for other topological constructions. That's my story, and I'm sticking to it.